Hello, everyone. My name is Jessica Lanita, and I'm a junior at Livermore High School, and I'm currently the president of Interact Club. So I wrote the little speech, and I'm happy that Phil Dean has invited me today to talk about our club and about our presidency from this year. So here I go. Okay. So being club president is one of the greatest experiences I ever had. At first I thought this position was too hard, or it's too hard to handle, or there's a lot of things to keep in mind of. I always thought I was a follower, not a leader. I was afraid my decisions would turn out the way I didn't expect it, but I had my friends by my side telling me that I got this and I'll do great. So I took the challenge. My year being president was amazing. I have witnessed others inspiring others and changing other lives. I have watched my club getting stronger and stronger, especially watching them grow as a family. I am so proud of my club, and I couldn't be any happier. I love each and everyone in my club, and they're my inspiration. I had times where things were getting a little difficult, but I had my officers by my side helping me out. My officers are the greatest group of people greatest group of students I ever worked with. I love them so much, and I'm sad that two of them are going to be graduating soon, but I know that in the future that they're going to do better things. We are a family, and family have each other's backs, and that's why I wouldn't change anything to anyone, exchange any of them to anyone. I have never had any regrets joining Interact. Interact has impacted my life in so many ways. I have met new friends who are like my second family. I have learned new leadership goals. I have experienced new things I never done before. If I didn't join Interact, I wouldn't be here talking to in front of you amazing Rotarians. But overall, thank you, Rotarians, for all your love, hard work, and especially your support. I love Interact, and I wouldn't change anything about it. For the money that we raise, we have split our funds into local, national, and international. We'll be donating $1,500 to the Livermore Valley Education Foundation. We'll be donating another $1,500 to Make-A-Wish, and we'll donate $3,000 to the Answer Is the Sun, to the which is the District 5170 Interact Club's goal for it. And that is where we are gonna send solar cookies to refugee camps in Afghanistan. And it is hard to finally say that next year will be my last year of Interact, but I'm going to cherish every moment and every event. And I'm glad to announce that I'll be president again next year with one of my best friends who's gonna be my vice president. So I can't wait for next year, for more challenges, more experience with everyone in this room. And finally, I would like to say thank you to some people in this room. I'm sorry if I missaid your last name, but I would like to say thank you to Bill Nebo and Jackie Cartwright for being the best Rotary Advisors for our club. I'd like to say thank you to Phil Dean for everything that you've done for our club as well. I'd also like to say thank you to Kathy Coyle. I love you so much. You're the best. And I'd like to say thank you to Yvonne Hopkins for adding the show to them. And I'd like to say thank you to Millie Sebo and Sando. And lastly, I'd like to say thank you to Dr. and Mr. Perry for like the love and support you give me, even for my family. I love you so much. Sorry, I didn't know I was going to cry today, but thank you so much, and I can't wait for next year.
Based on the recommendations of Bill Nebo and Jackie, we'd like to declare Jessica Interactor of the Year.
Aww.
Michael Ferrucci, did you want to say anything about your concert?
There were a few Rotarians that showed up, and I think...
Thank you very much. It was a wonderful event. We had a tremendous amount of support from the Bothwell Art Center, and the attendance wasn't that great. We only sold like 29 tickets. But it was more like a house concert and kind of a teaser concert, I'll say, because it was such a wonderful event. A lot of volunteers, and the music was sensational. And I would probably defer to Don and to our greeter.
Bruce
was there, and Randy was there. So, but if you want any testimony besides myself, I'm a little biased. But it was a wonderful event. And so we made a little over $350, about $390. But it was amazing, a lot of exposure for Rotary. And I want to say thank you to people that were there. All right.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Coyle.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a really great pleasure today to be here to introduce our recipients of the 2014 Ed Runstrom Career Technical Vocational Scholarships. And for those of you who don't remember Ed or never knew Ed, the scholarships are named after him because he was an extraordinary educator and an extraordinary Rotarian. And because of all that he did in the school district, he started as a teacher and wound up being superintendent of LVJ USD when it was a baby district. It was 1969. He was a longtime Rotarian. He was in this club for 55 years, and he always loved vocational scholarship work. So we renamed the scholarship in his honor in 2005. So today I have two recipients of this of the scholarship. And it's $1,000 each, and they're welcome to reapply next year. The scholarship is limited to career, technical, vocational careers. Students who are going to go to a four-year university or college are not eligible for this. It is strictly for vocational. And I'm really pleased to say that when we got the applications, Niall and I looked them over and we just went, wow. We were so excited. So I'm going to start, because there's a young man and a young lady. If it's all right, I'm still going to do ladies first. Okay. So I'm going to introduce Mary Jane Vigas. She is from Delville High School. And she is in the regional occupation, you can come up here. She is in the regional occupation program, and better known as ROP. And what ROP does is it pairs children, students with work training as part of their education. So I'm happy to say that she is well on her way to being an outstanding cosmetologist. And she is going to go to barber college as well. So she's going to know how to do real barber haircuts as well as women. So I wanted to say what she said in her application, just a little snippet, and she's going to say some words here. Growing up, my mother always styled and cut everyone's hair in the family. That intrigued me. It made me want to become a cosmetologist as well. What her teacher said was, Mary Jane is a real success story and a testament to the value of alternative education. She is winsome and animated. She really is those two things. I have told her many times, once you build up a client base, they'll pay to just sit and chat with you, whether they need their hair cut or not. That was from one of her teachers. And then another statement is, Mary Jane is always a pleasure to have on campus. She was always upbeat and positive. I am confident that she will complete the task at hand and accomplish the career goals she has planned. When Niall and I met her, Niall and I were the committee with her, she told us her story and her goals, and we were very impressed indeed. So I'm going to let her say a few words herself, but please welcome and congratulate Mary Jane Vigas.
Hi, everyone.
As you know, my name's Mary Jane Vigas, and first off, I would like to thank everyone for giving me such an awesome scholarship. I'll be using it towards my barbering school once I finish cosmetology, and I'm honestly couldn't be more excited about it. I'll be graduating from Del Val this June, cosmetology in August, and then barbering in November. I then plan on working in a barbershop until I get the experience to go out on my own. I never knew there were scholarships for trade schools, and I think it's a really awesome program, and I hope more people will hear about it. And once again, thank you for such an awesome scholarship.
So I'm going to ask President Phil to come up and hand you your envelope and have the photo up, okay? Thank you, Mary Jean. You can sit right up now. Okay, our next recipient is Ryan DeForest, and he is in ROP at Livermore High School, and he has been involved in automotive rebuild, repair, customizing since he was a little boy. And what we learned about him is that he's been driving race cars and driving with his dad, Sean, over there, and also with one of our Rotarians. But he never told us that. And he never told this Rotarian that he was applying for the scholarship. He told him yesterday, and that is, I didn't even know that Lance Perovich had a racing team. But anyway, he's been working with Lance for about a year, and that came out it didn't even really come up in the interview, did it? So anyway, Lance has given him real accolades here. But I wanted to tell you what Ryan said about himself in his application. He said, "Cars are my passion. I enjoy the challenge of building, repairing, and customizing cars. I'm testing my skills on and off the racetrack by driving and crewing for my dad and Mr. Farovich." It turned out that Lance didn't know he applied, like I said. What his teachers said was he is a consistent attender and participant in class. Those are two really important things about being a student. Those were key words for me. He has taken on the responsibilities of making sure not only that he understands the topics being discussed, but also of sharing with his classmates to make sure that they understand it as well. And I thought that was really wonderful. He has the persistent nature that will allow him to succeed in the constantly changing world of automotives. In my mind, he is a kid that will go far. So when Niall and I met with him, we were impressed with his knowledge and how articulate he is about what it takes to paint a car, fix a car, do an engine, and all of those things. So I'm going to let him say a few words, Ryan, and congratulations.
Well, first and foremost, I want to thank Kathy for choosing me for this scholarship, and I really think it's something extremely impressive that we can have scholarship opportunities for kids to go to trade schools and, you know, enter the trades and not just have to go straight to a four-year college and feel all that pressure and the money and the expenses going into it so that they can be doctors and lawyers, but it's people who want to be mechanics and cosmetologists who build this country and make us do what we do. So I'm very grateful that I've been chosen for this, and I hope that I can fulfill my goals to the best of my ability. And I, like I said, how I am a constant attender, I will be there first one in and last one out every single day to get the job done. And thank you, all of you guys. Thank you.
Just have a little photo pop here.
Get a little closer together there. Where are we? Yes.
So in closing, I just want to say that it's been a real thrill for me and for Niall to be a part of this year and have such two extraordinary young people to meet. and new friends, and their parents are wonderful. So I'm really thrilled to do this and do this again. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Kathy. Now we have a ready update from Manny.
Afternoon, everyone.
Manny, can I have you look at me, please? Even smile.
Let me take a few minutes to talk about three things with you. I want to describe our Ready program, which is unique to us and our club. Talk about it in the way of the progress we've made over the last few years. And then talk about the program's future, where we're headed for the future. In describing the Ready program, one would take the name Ready, and it translates into Rotarians Enriching and Directing Youth. And that's what we are in the business of doing. It's unique to our club. It's the program to help the low-performing schools, which and the students that are attending that school. And we've targeted the school in the way of grades. 6th through 8th graders are the ones we are trying to work with. And also, from the standpoint of the school, it's a low-performing school, low-income school, multilingual school. So there's and low income. So all of those are factors that qualifies the school to be part of the Ready program for us. We've been in Junction School, which is a school selected here in Livermore, for 4 years now. It doesn't seem like it's been that long, but it's been 4 years we've been there. We work with students from the 5th grade to the 8th grade. That's what we've been doing. In all subjects. So when you go in, you don't know necessarily what students may need help in what homework. We meet right after school. Students don't get a break in between. They go straight from the last class into the library where we meet with the students for about an hour. We try to match the students with the needs that they help in certain subject areas with Rotarians who've been part of the program over these years. And especially with knowledge in certain subjects that the students will have and need help on the homework that they have to turn in. Once the students have said they finished their homework, what do we do now? Rotarians hopefully will sit with them and talk about anything that student wants to talk about, even the questions that might be the ones that the Rotarians will raise. Once a month, students, as part of the enriching activity, are signed up to go on field trips. We take them on field trips so they get to see what they're learning in school has relevance to the world of work. And the enrichment activities now have sort of shown students the world of work in a variety of ways. We've visited some amazing places over the last 4 years. Cattle Ranch. We've been to the hospital, to the fire department, to the police department, to the California Academy of Science in San Francisco, to the Oakland Science Museum in Oakland, to the Exploratorium in San Francisco, to the Recreation Center here in Livermore, to the Livermore Airport, to the Bankhead Theater, to the Railroad Museum, to the Poppy Hills Golf Course. And this year, we went down to cap off this year's program down to Monterey and visited the Monterey Bay Aquarium. The participants, we have about 25 students who are involved in the program. That varies on different days. And we meet every Monday at the school in the library right after school. It's mainly 6th to 7th graders now, with about a third of the group being young girls. And the students are bilingual in the way of the language they typically speak as it's their first language, is Spanish is what's there. We divide up about one mentor to 2 to 3 students. Gotten feedback that we really need to have more mentors so we reduce that ratio down even a little bit further. The Interact students, Jessica and crew, have been with us for years now. They participated from the beginning, and they've been great help in working with the students. They act as a bridge to open up some of the little fifth graders or sixth graders in the program. What we've seen, though, now is what we're getting is attrition is setting in, meaning we're ending up with high school students headed off to college and with our blessings, but we need to then recruit again, which is, Jessica, we'll have that as a homework assignment if you recruit, recruit your replacement is the thing. We get involved in all areas, like I said, with the students going on for the future. And when I talk about future, let me talk about it in this way. We want to meet with students, and that'll be about 20 students. We're looking to go just a little bit larger than that, which then impacts the volunteers in the way of the Rotarians being a mentor for those students when they come in after school. We want to continue to focus upon homework and sort of life skills and set up a better communication between the mentors, the school, and their parents. We've pretty much left parents on the sideline. We see that that's an area for us to recruit and develop the lines of communications. We want to move from 7th and 8th graders typically this year to 5th through 7th graders. And when we raised that at the meeting, when we were meeting with the students, what we heard though was a reaction from the students in the back of the room that says, what about us 8th graders? We've been with you from the beginning. And so we want to be part of this program until I move into the high school. And we know we're going to be accommodating to that. The READY program is on track, like I said, it's to move towards 2025 students to work with. The budget will need to increase a little bit. So we get about $2,000 a year for especially the field trips, the snacks for after school is out, and any other admissions costs. We need more mentors, and that's the appeal to you, and especially women. We have about 20 students in the program, and for next year what we want to do is move that number on up. We meet with the students every Monday, right after school at 2:30 to 4. It takes about an hour, hour and a half. And so the question would be one of what impact are we having on students, or what impact could other clubs have on students by taking on a strategy like this? Think about it this way. Most of you received this new magazine, our latest Rotarian magazine. Just probably hit your mailboxes not long ago. But when you flip it open, the president in the front makes an appeal of having people get more involved in their communities with different program strategies. I don't know if it's Dr. Burton or Mr. Burton, but the president of Rotary, he was on our schedule about a month and a half ago when he came out to the West Coast. But assuming that his schedule got delayed, he did not get to come over and meet with the Interact kids and the READY kids over at the school. But he wrote read the introduction to this month's Rotarian. And I guess he captures quite well the point that what is expected and hoped for from Rotarians is getting involved and providing a sense of service, and especially as you head towards the earlier grades and earlier years. But if you also read in the Rotarian magazines, you get the statistics which are there. And it talks about Rotary International has 34,000 clubs. The number of members, 1.2 million members are Rotarians. What if they implemented a program like what we're doing here with about 20 kids in per each club? Even if it's only 10% of all the clubs internationally with Rotary, they would have an impact of about 68,000 kids being impacted around the world on the, each Monday, let's say. But even if it's 1%, you're talking about 6,800 kids being impacted and being influenced by people like you in the room. So what we've done is spent heading for five years now in working with those kids. And when I say we, would those of you who've had any time on the READY program, please stand for me. You know who you are. I don't want to call you out now. And then, as part of wrapping this up, is the one of we'd like to thank some people. And that is, we would not be where we are without Lori Dotson over at Junction School. So we know that. We've talked to her about it. She knows it. But letting you know, all know, that a program like ours would not work unless you had someone like a Lori Dotson who deals with students and also who deals with us as mentors as we go in. The last appeal that I have is the one that we know we want to reduce the ratio of Rotarians as mentors to a lower number. And to do that, we need some of you who would like to spend time with us and with the kids on a Monday doing mentoring over at the school. So talk to me if you have an interest in having an impact on the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mandy. If Linda Keim and Beth Wilson will bring their red badges up here, I'll trade them for a new blue badge. Also cost $15.
For me, right?
Yeah.
Oh, terrific. Thank you. $10. Thank you.
Smile.
Terrific work. Paul Brown.
Will Christian Chakwuma and Yvonne and Dave Hopkins please come to the podium? So have some Paul Harris Fellow Awards, if you haven't already guessed. Christian? Yours first? Okay. Congratulations, Christian. You have earned a Paul Harris Fellow Plus 2. Congratulations. See you here again next year. Thank you. And Yvonne, you're going to do the presentation to your husband. Here's the certificate and the pin, and here's the microphone.
Oh, good. She has to stand up in front of somebody to talk.
This is my favorite thing. Okay, so about the late 1980s, early 1990s, my husband was a member of Rotary. We were starting a business, starting a family, and things just didn't work out. But before he had left his tenure, he had gotten $600 into his Paul Harris fund. And in 2002, David Lowell stopped into my office and said, "Why aren't you a member of the new club that's chartering here in Pleasanton? It's right next door." So I joined. And of course, promptly then, because California is a property, what is it?
Community
property, that's the word. I attached his $600, added my four, and got my first Paul Harris. I'm going on to get a couple, three more, and then it occurred to me that probably didn't match the four-way test. So I'm very proud to I'm very proud to now present him almost 20 years later with his Paul Harris.
Thank you. Okay, we can't top that. Just wanted to remind you, we're still doing Polio Plus fundraising. Money's still coming in. Still time to get matching Polio Plus points. The deadline is June 1st. So if you feel so inclined, the pledge cards are on the table. Thank you.
of a very fast introduction of the people who participated in the Habitat for Humanity program. Would you all please stand? Everyone who worked on it did a very tough job and a very tough job.
This is not a precedence, you know, so to speak. We want to hand out not any clothes to replenishing your energy, but this is a power drink that I just bought just as a gesture that has, you know, vitamin B3, B6, and B12. The reason why I did that was, one, I screwed up. I didn't realize that many people sign up and they forget they signed up. So when I was sending my reminders, I was forgetting to put on the bottom of the email, you signed up, please show up. So anyway, only 7 people showed up, and that caused tremendous amount of work on part of these people. Ken broke his head. Amazing, blood all over the place. And I'm talking of intense hard work for people that showed up. So I want to thank you so much from my heart. You know, please replenish your energy. So very little with this drink, and I thank you so much. Again, it's not a precedence. The board at some point is going to determine the best way to acknowledge people. I feel like handing out $100 bills, but I can't afford that. So again, thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody. Our program today is going to be a good one. It's being presented by a gentleman that was born in Honolulu, or in Hawaii, on Wailuka, Maui. And he attended high school there, and then he went to Seattle University and got a degree in political science. He was commissioned as second lieutenant in the infantry, served in Vietnam as a motor platoon leader, and then with the 4th Infantry Division. In other ways, and he came back and went to work for the Pacific Telegraph and Telephone for a number of years. Retired in '96, and in 1997, he took on a big job with the East Bay Stand Down, and he's going to tell us about that. It's a program for homeless and displaced veterans, and he's been the director of that now since 1998. It's a big job. So please, at this time, he has a lot of other little things here, but we don't have too much time to tell you. He serves a lot of veterans groups. But please now, welcome, speaking on this wonderful program, East Bay Stand Down, Jerry Yaharo. Jerry.
Thank you, John, and thank you, Rotarians, for the opportunity to speak here. I want to also thank Bob Tocnock and his group, because you've been there before. I think you have been, your organization has supported us since 1999, the first Stand Down. What is Stand Down? Stand Down is an event that takes place every 2 years. We bring in about 450 homeless and desperate veterans, and try to break that endless cycle of homelessness and despair that affects many of our veterans that have served honorably our country. Why do we do this? Because veterans are in need out there. Just this morning, our president was talking about the situation in the VA services. Let me make it a point where when we returned from Vietnam, let me start way back. How many Vietnam veterans do I have here? Anybody? Please stand.
What's the question?
How many Vietnam veterans? Thank you for your service. Welcome home. How many other veterans do we have here? Just raise their hands. Thank you all for your service. I don't know about World War II, Korea, or other periods of conflict. But when we came home from Vietnam, was the VA your first choice for seeking your medical services? No. Because the VA at that point in time was in dire straits. They have upgraded their services today where they are the largest healthcare system in the United States and in fact in the world. That big an organization, you're going to see some detrimental services, and that's what's going on today. But I can stand here and say, for me, the Veterans Administration today assist us, and without their help, we could not do the East Bay stand down. So, you know, so I'm a backer of the Veterans Administration. Many of us, when we came home from war, we took our uniform off. The military was great in training us how to fight. However, they were very poor in how to survive the battles we fought and how to deal with ourselves after war. Consequently, that still carries on today. Many veterans getting out of the service have not been diagnosed with either physical or mental injuries and are not being treated. East Bay Standout attempts to make this correction. We offer all of the services a veteran possibly needs. In 4 days, we have mental, we have medical, we have dental, we have drug, alcohol, rehabilitation services. We have legal services. We feed them, we clothe them, we put them up for the 4 days. Just to give you an example, when they come in on Thursday, they're disheveled, many of them are dirty, they're confused, and Bob can testify to this. After the 4 days of stand down, when they go back on the buses, back to where we found, picked them up, they now look clean, shaved, brand new clothes, demeanor is happy. It is us, the volunteers, that have been there the 4 days that ended looking like they did coming out on Thursday. But the dedication that I have from my volunteers is such that, you know, without everybody, we can't do it. People always thank me for the services, but I turn around and say, no, thank our community. Basically, I know we're running short of time, so I want to open up questions on the floor about East Bay Stand Down and why we do it and how we do it. So are there any questions?
Yeah, how do we volunteer?
Okay, the volunteer, there are a few brochures on each table. I was not aware that this was such a large Rotary organization, so I'm very surprised. But there's brochures on the table. Our website is www.eastbaystanddown.org, all one word. In about the middle of July, we will put up our volunteer website. And it'll ask you questions when you're available, name, email address, and so forth, and days that you'll be able to volunteer. Oh. Yes, sir.
Yes. I just wanted to ask, is there any provision in your program for follow-up? A lot of people that get treated during those 4 days, I imagine, need or could benefit by some kind of follow-up that may augment what they're already getting.
One of the biggest portion of stand down is we work with the community service providers. And what we like to do is encourage the participants to come in, register with one of these community providers into rehab programs, shelter rehab programs. We would like these individuals to sign up and be available Sunday when the East Bay Stand Down ends. These agencies will then pick them up and take them directly to their shelters and provide them with the care that they need. So that's the kind of follow-up we do. Individual follow-ups that the East Bay Stand Down does is all, does not exist. Because of the restrictions on freedom of privacy, secrecy of information, we cannot follow individual participants and followed their success.
When and where is the next standout?
Next standout is September 11th, 12th, 13th, and 14th, Alameda County Fairgrounds.
How are they housed in tents?
We build a tent encampment. The whole atmosphere of the East Bay standout is like a military organization. We put them back into the probably the last comfortable situation that many of these veterans have experienced. So we build the camaraderie back based on their time in the service. So we put them up in military tents, bunks.
Didn't you use Camp Parks at one time?
Yes, with the first two, three stand downs were held at Camp Parks.
And you can't use that? Or?
No, basically it was the area. The Alameda County Fairgrounds offers grass. There was almost no grass at Camp Parks. The services that they offer, basically, Alameda County Fairgrounds affords us anything that they have that we can use. Tables, chairs, they don't charge us for electricity, water, or anything like that.
Racetrack.
Can female veterans participate?
Yes. Sadly, we anticipate 2012 we have about 35 veterans, female veterans. Sadly, I think we're going to have more this year. About 20% of the existing military are now women. Consequently, we anticipate there'll be a lot more. Sadly, many of them will be there suffering from sexual trauma. So we have designed programs anticipated just for their needs. Back in the room.
As an organization or as a community service group, are we able to sign up in mass?
Yes. Although there are only a few large areas, I think that you can volunteer as a group. The kitchen is one of them. The
that's what we've done before.
Right. Rotary does the breakfast on Saturday morning. And I've seen many, we have many representatives from the various Rotary organizations.
I can be a witness to this event. I've taken our Boy Scout troop there probably six times. And we do trash collection in the evenings, mostly is what we do. And it's been it's great for the kids. The kids get to see veterans. They get to be in the area. They have a great sense of accomplishment when they help these men. So as our group, and I think Boy Scouts do a lot of that stuff for you, collecting trash. Yeah.
The last, we depend on the Alameda County Fairgrounds to provide us with the area and facilities. We'd like to do it in August when the Boy Scout troops are not going to school. So they're there during the daytime to help us police. They've shifted us and put us back into September. Last year, in 2012, in replacing the Boy Scouts, the parents of the scouting troop were there, and they did the cleanup and the picking up and the recycling of materials. So thank you to the parents of these scouts. Any other questions? Bob, do you have anything you want to talk about your experience?
Saturday night dinner, we historically prepare that.
That's right, Saturday dinner.
So that's something that we could always use a lot of help. We need a lot of servers, a lot of people doing prep work, and also the cleanup in the kitchen. So that's because you're serving about 700-800 meals on Saturday night.
All participants, the military that is on site, and volunteers get fed. Yes, sir.
What specific programs do you do in terms of like medical and?
Medical, we do almost everything. If we have a critical case that needs to be transported, we work with the local hospital in Pleasanton, where if need be, we can evacuate an emergency case to them. And if not, if it's something that can be taken care of at a VA facility, we will evacuate the individual to the VA facility. Dental is another important area that we'll do again this year. dental coverage in the VA, you need to be 100% disabled to get dental treatment from the VA. Many of us aren't 100%. So what's the first thing to go? You're out there, you're, you know, you may have a job or be homeless, family. You're not gonna spend money on your teeth. You're gonna try to take care of the family and kids. So we see a lot of cases of very bad dental care. So we've hired, this year we're planning on having 3 dental vans. There'll be 9 units, offices that all full dental treatment can be given.
Question, there's a reason that this isn't held every year?
We did it, the first one was 1999, we did it in 2000. It nearly killed the volunteers and killed us almost financially. So in after the 2000 stand down, we took a look at what we were doing and decided that we couldn't do it every year. It's a 4-day, we are the only 4-day event, stand down in the nation. So we elected to do it every two years and to provide the best services that we could. Yes, sir.
From where do you gather these veterans?
Throughout the Bay Area. We have registration sites that they'll come in, and we have assigned pickup points that we'll bring them in on Thursday.
So that includes the San Francisco side, the south side of the Bay, the north side of the Bay?
All 9 counties of the Bay, and at times we even get them coming in from the San Joaquin Valley.
How do you get the word out to them for them to be aware of this? What's your means of communication to these people that could be homeless or what have you?
By working with the community service agencies, the various VA facilities, and this year we're going to try something a little different and work with the park services and local police departments. They know where the hardcore homeless are. So we're going to try to get these individuals in on a priority basis. The hardest problem with that is if you're a hardcore homeless, you're not going to want to come in and, I mean, the services are always out there, but if for whatever reason they're homeless, they are not easy to convince to make it to stand down. So our job is to convince them to at least give stand down and try. All right? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jerry. I think you're doing a perfect job. We have here for you either a bottle of Olivina olive oil or a bottle of wine. Your choice.
The olive oil.
The olive oil. Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Earlier when Manny was talking, he said he mentioned somebody I hadn't heard of. And I think Lori Souza is no longer a member of this club.
What?
She changed her name. Is she here?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, she had to leave. Well, I was going to congratulate her about that. I did have something else in mind. I'm told that I need to read the last 4 numbers of the ticket instead of the last 3. Even though I think every ticket in the room is green now, I'll still read all 4. 8, 8, 5, 7. Do we have a winner?
We're in every crowd.
All right. This meeting is adjourned.